Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Shubhendu Parth, Consulting Editor of Voice and Data, and your host for today's webinar. It's my pleasure to welcome you all to the VND TLF dialogue on the World Telecommunication and Information Society Day. Today's dialogue on the role of telecom in crisis is the first of the three-part interactive series that we have planned with the TSPs. And today we have the Airtel leadership team with us, along with Cisco, the communication infrastructure provider. The webinar is hosted by Voice and Data, India's oldest telecom magazine from CyberMedia Group. Before we start, here are some housekeeping essentials. For the duration of the presentation, the participants' line will be on the listen-only mode. After the presentation, we'll have the question and answer session. You may send your question through the chat and we will take it up during the slotted time. Your feedback is also very important for us, so may I request all participants to send their feedback once the webinar is over. I would like now to introduce you all to our esteemed panelists for the day. I would like to welcome Mr. Akhil Gupta. Good afternoon, sir. Mr. Gupta is the Vice Chairman of Bharti Enterprises and Executive Chairman, Bharti Infratel. He has played a pivotal role in Bharti's phenomenal growth right since inception. He has led the formation of various partnerships for Bharti with leading international operators like British Telecom, Telecom Italia, Singapore Telecom, and Vodafone. He has also been instrumental in induction of leading financial investors and other private equity funds in the company. I also take this opportunity to welcome our second panelist, Ms. Sanjay Kaul, who is the President, Asia, Pacific and Japan, Service Provider Business Group of Cisco Systems. Mr. Kaul is a hardcore ICT professional with over 25 years experience across Europe, Asia and Africa. He is a highly respected ICT leader who has over years advised telcos, including mobile, fixed operators, ISPs and policymakers on various strategic, financial, and operational issues. He is also the author of Business Models for Sustainable Telecom Growth. Welcome, Mr. Kaul. We also have with us Ms. Harmeen Mehta, who is the Global Chief Information Officer of Bharti Airtel. She strongly believes that we are all some of our experiences and that she's an outcome of different cultures and thoughts and a product of human technology. She started with the airlines industry, worked with Qantas Airways and then with British Airways before moving to the financial sector and then to Airtel in 2013. She's been looking after the entire information infrastructure and the digital transformation at the Bharti Airtel. We also have amongst us Mr. Randeep Singh Sekhon, the Chief Technology Officer of Bharti Airtel. Mr. Sekhon has a defense background, having started his career with Indian Air Force. He is passionate about transforming the position of mobile operators from across providers to digital lifestyle providers, delivering value to its customers via customer first and digital first strategy. He moved to the telecom sector in 1997 and has served in different capacities across India, Malaysia and Indonesia. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd also like to welcome our moderator for today's discussion, Mr. Pradeep Gupta. Is the chairman of CyberMedia Group. Mr. Gupta is a first generation entrepreneur who set up CyberMedia in 1982. He is an industry veteran with over 40 years of experience. PG, as he's called, is highly reputed in IT industry. He has mentored over 150 startups and is the co-founder of Indian Angel Network. He is the chair of Alumni Trust, the sponsors of Ivy Cap Venture Trust Funds, and is also on the board of IIM Calcutta Innovation Park. I now hand over the session to Mr. Gupta and request him to take the discussion forward. Over to you, PG.
Thank you very much, Shubhendu. And thank you very much to all the panelists as well as all the attendees. Today I know is a Sunday, but then you know in the COVID era, I think all Sundays are working days, or all working days are Sundays. But today being Telecom World Telecom Day, we thought that it would be great to have this discussion. What we have done is that I had a discussion with all the panelists, and we've decided to keep this entire discussion as a very highly interactive one. So we are going to follow some of the principles that you find on, let's say, BBC debates, where there will be clear questions that would be coming from the moderator, and there will be short to-the-point answers that will be given by the panelists. The discussion is in three parts. In the first part, I will be talking about the last 60 days. And then after that, I will be talking about the new normal. And then in the third part, I will be talking about the digital infrastructure that is required. So let's start immediately with the first part of the discussion, which is on the last 60 days. And I will start with my question for Mr. Akhil Gupta. Mr. Gupta, it is beyond doubt that the COVID crisis has shown that the telecom sector has been at the forefront. You know, how did the government and the industry collaborate together? How did the happen? What sort of war rooms were set up? What were the challenges that were faced? You know, how did you manage this this entire crisis management?
Well, good afternoon, everybody. For telecom industry, I think crisis management is not anything new. For the last 25 years, we have been managing crisis after crisis, whether it's earthquake or it is floods. They keep happening, and therefore, I think this is one industry which is always perhaps the best prepared to handle any crisis. Undoubtedly, COVID is something of an extreme nature, unprecedented, and I must say the coordination which we have always seen between the industry, the telecom operator, the IP1 providers, and the governments has actually risen to the occasion. And I've never seen better coordination in all the crises that we have faced together over the last several decades. Especially, I think, kudos to DOT, really proactive, and also to the state governments, who each one of them have gone out of the way to facilitate the movement of material and people. And I don't think this crisis could have been handled in a more seamless manner like we were able to handle this. So this is a great example of how this was done. Of course, there were usual war rooms and so on, which we create at times of emergencies. But the role of DOT and state governments is really commendable, because as service providers, it is really our job. But the way they have come to the occasion is really remarkable.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Akhil, for laying that entire background. Sanjay, you know, the speed and the connectivity which has been required in the last 60 days has been unprecedented in our lifetime. You know, the level of connectivity, collaboration, security, all of that moved up by several factors, you know, in a very, very short period of time. How did Cisco work with the service providers and ensure that there was business continuity? What were some of the lessons that were learned from the crisis?
Thank you, PJ. Thank you, first of all, for inviting me to this session. I think it's a really important one. Now, let me begin with, first of all, expressing gratitude to the telecom industry. I mean, Bharti executives are here present, but others as well. I think, honestly, I didn't believe, you know, when we hit the crisis that we will, as an industry, manage it. I think you guys did an incredible job, and all the people that are out there keeping us connected, making what we're doing right now possible is worth a lot of praise and gratitude. So thank you so much for that, first of all, right? So I think it has been enormous challenge. I mean, we might like to say that Cisco always was virtual, I mean, we have had the tool set for almost a decade, you know, both the collaboration tools and the security assets and so on. But it was overwhelming, you know. Just to give you a state of the nation, the worldwide, in April alone, the world consumed 48 billion minutes of WebEx. And we are one of the players. I mean, so there were there are 5 million meetings that take place on a daily basis on our infrastructure. We have seen 20 million new security customers that we've signed, and DO, which is double authentication, one of the capabilities that we offer the market, we got 3,500 new customers. So it has been unprecedented demand for activities, you know, that are pretty much linked to what we are doing now, making sure people are getting seamless connection and the security is taken care of it. So I think that is kind of the scale we've had to deal with. In terms of how we supported operators, I mean, obviously what we saw overnight when the COVID hit in different countries, we started with China, which was a little bit early, and we saw that the peering traffic for the operators, you know, hit the roof. I mean, there wasn't many operators that were used to work from home. So it was an overnight shift. So China actually had prepared us a little bit to deal with the chaos. But then it became so big over 2 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks, that I think we had glitches. I think we had issues first couple of weeks, but we've been constantly doubling the capacity to make sure the WebEx is in order, the collaboration solutions in order. Second thing, what we've done is we went public to all our service provider customers and offered them this capability free of charge for 6 months. And I think some of them already had good solutions in place. They probably didn't need it. But those who didn't, we made them active overnight. So that was the second thing we did. Similarly, I think we ensured that those who needed the security capabilities were put in place. So, and on top, I think all of that honestly was, you know, more than business for us. It was making sure that the industries float, and it was a lot of free stuff given in those first 4 weeks. But, you know, as we move now into May, we see that good gesture is now turning into business. I think some of them actually, at least 25% of them are coming back and want it permanent, because so far it doesn't seem there's an end to this. So all in all, I think we've been there. We had the back of the SPs, our customers who were already kind of consume our technologies, but also those who didn't. So that's how, in a nutshell, I think we try to help SPs all over the world, not specifically in India.
So thank you, Sanjay, for that. Randeep, moving on to you. You handle the tech backbone. You know, I saw a report which said that this is a slightly dated report, but it said that it was in 2018 to 2023, in 5 years, fixed broadband would grow by 2.7 times, mobile devices 3.2 times, mobile connection 3.5 times. It talked about, you know, 8.5% of the connections would be more than 100 Mbps and so on. I think all these records have been broken in the last 2 months. There has been unprecedented consumption of bandwidth, of different kind of on different variety of telecom devices. What was the surge like, and were there any changes in the pattern of that surge? And you know, how did the industry and Airtel manage that surge, not just in demand but in the pattern?
Well, thank you. I hope you can hear me clearly. There was a definite surge, and it happened very fast, because moment the lockdown was announced and people went into lockdown, the traffic really hit. Our traffic, we saw increase almost 30%. on a day's average on mobile, slightly less on home because on home broadband, which is fiber to home. So there was a big increase. There was a change in pattern was the traffic moved from commercial locations to home. So a lot of traffic, almost home traffic, almost.
Randeep, we have lost you.
Randeep, your audio.
We have lost your audio. Randeep, we can't hear you.
While Mr. Randeep comes back, may I request you?
Yeah, okay. So I will proceed in the meantime while we just check what is the issue with Randeep's audio. Harmeen, you know, this brought about a change in the way of working also. Connected work, connected home, you know, which people had been talking that is a thing which will happen over 10 years, literally happened overnight. Companies had to still maintain productivity. They needed to collaborate. They need to get the collaboration tool. How did COVID changed the ecosystem? What were the resulting connectivity and security issues that came up, and how did the industry respond to it?
I think, Pradeep, if nothing else, this has proven that they say, necessity is the mother of all invention. But in this case, the tools and the invention needed to collaborate and for all companies to run virtually have actually already been there for a long while, and some organizations have been using them very, very, very effectively. You know, within engineering, we do as much work in the night when you're doing deployments and, you know, everything that you can't do during the day, as much you do during the day, and most of that happens remotely. You know, we have X Labs in Bangalore and circles all around the country and circle offices there. So in a way, remote working to some companies, while it has come naturally, but not to this extent. But it has proven that a lot of the limitations are actually limitations in our minds rather than actually limitations of technology. Where there is a will, there is a way. The moment we wanted to adopt that technology and everybody adopted it, it was literally within days that entire companies and countries have been running virtually. Half the world was quarantined at one point in time consecutively for over a period of 2 weeks, and confined to their homes and under house arrest. And somehow the whole world ran. So I actually think it was much more of unlocking of the minds and, convincing, instead of convincing people up or below hierarchies, either ways, that this is an alternative way that in the 21st century companies can run this way as well. That is the biggest barrier that got broken. Technology was always there. Some companies were using it more, some were using it lesser. The ones who were using it lesser just adopted those and life went on. At Airtel, we enabled over 55,000 people working from home, and it took us 48 hours to get everybody enabled to be able to function and run the company from home. And I think there's no excuse that anybody has anymore. Companies have done their year-end closing, quarter closing, month closing, everything in the month happens in the month of March. It's a month, quarter, and a year-end. And all India did that remotely, worked fine. We've been running, being an essential services for the country and supporting as much the government as well as not only the consumers, whether it's Randeep's knock or it's been, my data centers or all the applications, everything has been running fine. I think the surge has been massively towards digital, and we can talk about that later, where almost all companies have seen the digital adoption literally go up like a hockey stick, and we can go into that later. And then, of course, lots of security concerns, more so because, every malicious intent person out there now knew that all the companies have opened up all their connectivity to, much more than normal out of their offices and into the homes as well. So I think phishing attacks, lots of those things have gone up like 200-300%. And I can share more stats as we discuss more later.
Wonderful. It ties in very well to the next set of questions which I have on the new normal. But before that, I'll just go back to Randeep because we lost you midway. You were talking about 30% surge that happened in the traffic, and that is the but you were talking about the change in the pattern. That is the time when we lost you. So
sorry,
you know.
I don't know. I mean, it's but let me continue from there. So change in pattern was the commercial location saw a traffic drop. Residential saw a traffic increase. Residential traffic increased almost 100%. So overall, the traffic increased 30%. Then the cities lost traffic. It went to suburbs and went to rural area. Rural area saw a huge increase in traffic. A lot of people did shift to the rural areas. Then I think the shift was on the pattern. Generally, we get in mobile or any telecom, we say M curve. There is a peak in later part of the day for data, say around 7 to 9 p.m. But then the data consumption became all flat. All through the day, the consumption was high. Different consumers consuming differently. The usage changed. I mean, you saw a lot of surge on OTT videos, whether it is YouTube or Netflix or Prime or Hotstar or even Airtel Extreme. We found that people were really consuming video. But the other consumption was something similar to what we are doing now, which is online for students, for doing online classes, for people, corporate India to work from home. So we had to connect them through mobile. We had to connect them through FTTH. And to handle that, we had to add some soft capacities. We, you can say immediate addition of capacities. Luckily, we work on a cloud platform where it is very easy. Hardware is there. We are very easy to scale in and scale out and manage the additional demand on traffic. Doing that, we were able to serve well, and people were able to do whatever they wanted to do. We partnered with government also on supporting government's deal on tracking how the traffic is moving so that they can do their activities according to people we are moving, and to also enable the launching of Arogya Setu app, which also needed a partnership with the telcos. So we did our bit, and also our corporate customers especially, because they needed to also work from home, their staff, and had needed even bigger pipes for the central location so that they can connect remotely to their central data centers to run their business smoothly. So overall, it was very active a few weeks, but post that, as we say, new normal, now it is lying at that, and it's more stable, I would say.
Wonderful. So now let's talk about the new normal. Akhil, a tough question for you. You know, you are the person who has been behind architecting different business models, not just for Airtel, but for the telecom industry itself. Okay, whether it was, you know, the permanent change, or whether it was the tower infrastructure sharing and so on. So, you know, what is the new normal in terms of the new business model that will emerge out of this?
Well, I think one thing is very clear, that from now onward, the world will work remotely. More and more work will be remote. Therefore, naturally on the telecom side, and I'll confine myself to the connectivity bit, I'm not going to talk about the business models emerging on various services and various applications. I think Harmeen should be talking more about that. But let me confine to the business model for a pure telco or a telco point of view. I think two parts to the business model question. Part A is more of what we already do. But that is going to be a significant shift too, which is that the mobile networks, to my mind, will need to be far more robust, they'll be far more deep, and the capacity is a question where obviously there's one limitation of spectrum. What can we do to enhance the capacity to the maximum? And I'm sure you'd want to ask Randeep, he would be the best guy, and Sanjay, to tell us what can we do with limited spectrum to create maximum capacity, because capacity requirement is going to be endless, absolutely endless. That's one part. The basic infrastructure in terms of optic fiber, in terms of the small cells, will have to be enhanced many times over. But the main part which I think can be a new business model and should be a new business model is India has a tremendous opportunity to introduce 5G now. We all know at the current prices which have been set for auction, there's no way 5G will come into this country for the next few years. I think this is the time when the government of India, the TSPs, and the infrastructure providers need to collaborate. Now, let me tell you how we can all collaborate together. The need is very high-speed internet at every workplace. That could be home, that could be office. And therefore, my suggestion had been the government should give us the 5G spectrum on 3500 megahertz now. I think Randeep will talk more about it, and Sanjay in particular. Perhaps 50 megahertz should be enough to provide fixed wireless broadband. Now, that's a part of, as you know, the national digital communication policy as well. The telecom service providers can provide the network. IP1s can provide the outdoor units and the Wi-Fi setup inside the buildings. And I think this combination can truly put India at the forefront of 5G. A new business model will emerge. The aim in the digital policy that India should have very deep internet connectivity, broadband connectivity. Impossible to do it by wireline. We all know it, that in terms of time, in terms of cost, in terms of economics, it cannot be done on wireline very quickly. On wireless, it can be done very, very quickly, I'm sure. So that is, I think, one piece which I really feel this industry, one, the country needs it, and this industry can introduce it very quickly. That could be a new business model which we really should be looking at. Back to you, PJ.
Sorry, I was mute. Sanjay, Akhil posed the question to you, that how do you see, as an infrastructure provider, how do you see that role of a company like Cisco, in terms of ensuring that this new normal happens? Sanjay, you are on mute. Can you unmute? Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't realize I was on mute. So what I was saying is that Harmeen articulated pretty well that, technology has been there. When we talk about 5G and the architectures behind 5G, I think it's all about virtualization. It's all about cloudification. It's all about ensuring that we have security at every element of this network architecture. And it's about capturing the data when it gets produced, because value lies in how quickly you address the data, you do it. So all these four things, if we look from a technology perspective, I think it's been there. And I believe COVID is really post-COVID. We have a motivation to accelerate it. Challenge in many parts of the world, including India, was that the spectrum fee that the government wanted to charge for this 5G just threw the business case out of the window. I mean, there always was the need. It just didn't make sense with those prices. So what we are seeing a trend globally, and I hope that that becomes the case in India, is telecom is given a status of essential service. So when that happens, clearly, you don't overburden the industry with the taxes. You look at ways and means to support telcos, because typically in this environment, telcos becoming the rock bed, front and center of keeping the other industries up and running. I think there are many, many use cases we are exploring. And I can tell you a little bit our thinking as a company, but I mean, we clearly see, start with the consumer service. I mean, of course, Randeep talked about that the bandwidth needs a shifting to the homes. Obviously, because we all work from homes, we are streaming videos, we are watching movies, we are doing video conferences, our kids are busy playing multiplayer games. I mean, all of them create use cases where 5G will be required, right? So I think that's kind of one piece. The second piece is that the user behavior had to evolve, because to be honest, we couldn't assess, was there a market for multiplayer gaming in India? Believe you me, I mean, we're fortunately stuck. Our maid is at home. with us. It's three of us. She's playing multiplayer games. I think I told you this other day as well. So that is the behavior that didn't exist before. So I think that's great for the industry, because that means that consumers are going forward willing to pay for that. And to make these kind of use cases work effectively, you need attributes of 5G. So from that perspective, as Mr. Gupta alluded, the 5G looks closer than we thought. I think what is all needed is the positive interventions from regulators and funding agencies. You know, I mean, there is many interested parties around the globe that want 5G accelerated in nations like India, because that gives access to information to the masses and so on and so forth. So all that is good. Now, you ask me what is it that kind of Cisco will do in this particular. So if I come point to that question, I think, you know, we have seen over the last 2-3 years where all telcos are preparing for 5G. You know, 5G for Randeep is not that he has to start from scratch, or Harmeen. I think they have done a lot of stuff to be ready for that. My sense is probably they need to put a 5G radio and they will be ready, right? And for that, you need spectrum at a cost we just talked about. So I see transformation happening on four fronts. The first front is, you know, why you need to make the network simple, because we build these networks starting with 2G, then 2.5G, then 3G, 4G, now we're planning for 5G. So as a result, networks have become very, very complex. You know, I said you need to treat the data when it gets produced. Today, this data transfers through at least 6 routers before it hits the intelligent core. So the first piece is flatten this network, make it intelligent, make sure you have automation end to end. I think that's piece number one. Number two is the data center. You know, as an industry, we build monolithic data centers, probably in a country like India, maybe one in each metro. And then every bit that got produced out there was brought back into the central repository. I think that game is over. Now we need to look at creating multiple data centers at the edge. So when the consumer or an enterprise consumes the data, you capture it, you apply insights, analytics, apply security, and give that enterprise or consumer the value he's looking for, right? So that's the second shift. And you know, there are many names in the industry for this. They call it mobile edge compute, some call it multi-service edge. But in a simple definition, you need multiple mini data centers at the edge that take care of this. So that's the second piece of transformation. Third one is what I call Uberization of OSS bases. I think if you look at, I've been in this industry almost 3 decades, and I my previous career, and I think these systems, yeah.
Sanjay, your point 3 and 4, can we take it in the next segment, which is on the digital infrastructure?
Okay. Okay. All right.
So you know, just sort of stepping to the new normal. And by the way, what you said about, internet services as an essential services is something that has come as a message has come from 2 or 3 participants who've been saying that, the government should make this as essential services and sort of stop charging astronomical prices for it. They should stop milking the cow. Those are some of the things that I'm reading here. But coming to you, Randeep, because there are some questions that are coming on that as well. One question is that what are the fixed wireless access technologies that Akhil talked about? Which are the ones that you think will be coming forth? You know, what are some of the 5G? What are the next gen Wi-Fi devices? Those are going to be there. Your view on what kind of technologies will be required for this new normal? You are on mute. Randeep, you are on mute. You have to unmute yourself. Yeah. I'm sorry, we are not able to The mic is on, but we can't hear you. Randeep, I'm sorry. I'll come back to you. Let me go across to Harmeen with the next question. For solution providers, keeping the customers, and I think Akhil alluded to this also, keeping the fires going as far as the customers were concerned was very, very important. How do you keep the team safe? How do you make them productive? What are the new normals that you see? Do you see more of this happening in specific industries like healthcare, education, rapid response, critical technologies, or do you see this all across? Your views, please.
I think Pradeep, every industry is going to have to reinvent itself a little bit. It's not only about a new way of working, but it's also the impact that the consumer psyche is going to have on the industries as well. I think if nothing else, over the last few days, all of us who normally would do different kinds of spending have had all our focus on just the essentials. I mean, getting milk into the house has not been as easy as it was before. So things like that changes the priorities that you have in life. I think many people, many of us have gone through different moments of realizing that actually, what is it that is really essential in my life? And what is it that's not? And that's not a phenomenon that only a select few have experienced. Moreover, as industries go through and rebuild themselves, we are already hearing there is not only whether it's impact on millions and millions of jobs, people are dislocated in different places from where their livelihoods were. The whole country, economy, and the world is going to take some time to come back to normal as well. And like any other crisis, that itself, when it changes. You as a person, as an individual, as a professional, but it changes companies as well, and it changes economies, it changes industries. So we're just going to have to, just keep up with the time and see as all those things are evolving, keep evolving, and every industry is going to have to reinvent that. And I think us being the backbone for any and every industry, we will need the same level of focus. But I think what is changing is, in the last few weeks, I've seen us collaborating far more closer with the industries. We used to do with many, but not with all. And the way people have reached out and the way we've been able to work with the different kinds of industries, very different focus from telco working with the automobile industry. It was all about IoT, the new autonomous cars, etc. The last few weeks have been very, very different. As a focus with them. Same with the healthcare industry. We're working with, we collaborated very quickly with Apollo and launched something with them on our Airtel Thanks app, literally in a matter of less than a week. Normally, as companies, we would take weeks to just negotiate, saying, "Mere ko yahan pe button chahiye, I want to go here, why am I not getting Prime?" I mean, it's just that the focus has been so intense on getting things done. Everybody has taken bullshit out of their life and focused on what really matters. And that has streamlined us working with them as well. It's been all about going and doing things rather than just discussing at length on perfecting things as well. I think that is going to be a change. I hope that's a good change to stay as people across industries collaborate. I also feel one other piece that's going to make a real difference is the education industry is now going to have to work remotely for a much longer period of time. As we've seen, US, Europe have already declared that at least till December, they're going to have remote and online classes. I think this should also change how all of us, educate ourselves as well. We're all in the technology world where, you're never literate enough and you have to keep inventing in yourself. But I think it's going to change how the mass of the world also looks at both the healthcare and the education industry. I think they're both going to have to reinvent themselves. I think healthcare, a lot of focus is going to come for pandemics like this. A country of 1.3 billion Indians, almost a month and a half, 2 months, we've been in lockdown. But we still don't have millions and millions of beds in our hospitals. So in India, the entire care is going to move towards care from home. And how do you enable that? And that's again where telco will play a very critical role to be able to have, and I know there are lots of, the top medical houses in the country are doing a lot, and we are trying to work with them to really bring some of those solutions from the West into India, but at a much lower cost, that it can work for the economics of masked Indian, and not something that it becomes, again, care for the luxurious few. And I think those are some of those patterns, and we'll see how, you know, not everything can be talked about openly yet, still it's closed out. But I think a lot of those opportunities are here today, which, you know, we weren't giving the same, I would say, focus on steroids before. And this will really accelerate how we as a company also, and of course, India as a country, moves into the digital era. I think it's no longer seen as a luxury. It is going to become a norm. It's an essential. How people can, how hospitals can monitor millions of patients while at home, not everybody coming to the hospital, who needs to be in the hospital, how that care can also be expedited. Everything is, I actually feel, you know, the world is going to change.
Absolutely. I think, you know, you said it very well, that we've got a lot of bullshit out of our lives and we've started focusing on key things that are needed. Randeep, glad that you're back. You had heard the question and you had started the answer. We couldn't hear you, so...
Got it. Yeah. Now you can hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Sanjay had talked about, you know, flattening of the...
We talked about...
And then what are the technologies?
I agree with Akhil that ideally the best technology would be a fiber to your home and fiber to the building. But it is with such a vast country and still under penetrated on fiber, it will not be easy and will be a long task. I think fiber will be still needed to connect all the towers or majority of the towers for a backhaul for the wireless. But eventually wireless would be the mainstay connectivity for the masses.
I'm sorry, we lost you again.
Yeah, this is some trouble. So maybe I can, we promise we will back each other. Maybe I can pick while he's getting his.
Sure.
I think what Randeep is saying is, you know, country like India where fiberization is still a challenge. I think we have penetrated 38 to 40%. I mean, I don't think we can do it overnight to reach the 100% of other countries. So wireless will be the mainstream, and hence wireless technologies will have to take precedence. If you are back, Randeep, then you can continue from there. No, we still can't hear you.
We can, you know, we are getting the video, but we are not getting the audio at all, Randeep. So I don't know what the issue is, because we can see you, you know, absolutely sharply, but we can't hear you.
So maybe disconnect and connect back. That might help. So
just disconnect and connect back. Maybe that should work. Okay, so let me move on to the next area of digital infrastructure. Akhil, you know, the Prime Minister talked about Atmanirbhar Bharat, has already announced releasing of pending payments from the government. You know, the industry had been clamoring for that. There was a lot of payment which was stuck with the government. So this is all welcome news for the industry. You know, hopefully the packages that the FM comes up with will be for the telecom industry as well. What are your expectations there, you know, in terms of AGR, spectrum charges, incentives, you know, as I mentioned, the question from the audience which says the same thing that, in fact, another person from the participants has said that, you know, for migrants, shouldn't this entire service should have been made free of cost? Government should have been providing these subsidies. So the health of the industry is vital if it is a essential services, basically. What do you think should we be expecting, you know, from the government?
Well, first of all, I must say I have been a very, very strong supporter of the concept of Atmanirbharta or the self-reliance. Because no amount of doles, no amount of subsidies, no amount of external help or licensing or quotas or artificial barriers are going to help anybody in the long run. More so for individual companies, I think Atmanirbharta is an absolute must. And that's what, in context of telecom, I think government needs to realize that this industry will have to be self-reliant, it will have to be financially healthy. So I can tell you one thing, whatever each one of us has said, whatever Harmeen is talking of all the services, we're talking of all the connectivity, nothing is going to happen if we are a bankrupt industry. Therefore, as far as my expectation from government is concerned, it's twofold. First of all, let me be very clear that all that demand of ours about reduction in license fee and GST and so on and so forth, I personally don't have much hope on that, because very clearly government is going to run a big fiscal deficit, not as big as the 10% of GDP stimulus means, but still it's going to go up. I have really no hope that much will come our way there. But what I want the government to do is, number one, let us be Atmanirbhar. Therefore, please help us in becoming self-reliant. And one big step they can do is by putting a floor price on the tariffs. Because unless these tariffs increase, there is absolutely no way this industry can sustain. Now, I know this is against the principle of laissez faire and the fact that we want the government not to interfere too much. But unfortunately, the events in the past have led to a situation where there is absolutely no way this industry can have the right tariffs unless there is injection of floor price. So my request is that the DRAI has to put a floor price, complete that consultation quickly. That would be the biggest help towards self-reliant in the long run. Second piece is what they've already committed, which is in the NDCP, where they say that revenue maximization is not the goal of the government, but putting broadband internet to the masses is. If that is the aim, I think all I would request every part of the government to walk as talk. And therefore, leave this obsession of getting a massive upfront fee on 5G. I have heard right from 3 years back in Barcelona when Mrs. Aruna Sundaram, she mentioned that India wants to be the leader on 5G. I think today the situation is that forget the leadership, we are not even in the race. Because with the current prices, there is no way 5G will be introduced. And that is where I feel the government needs to come in and say that whatever you are wanting to commit or we were wanting you to commit on spectrum, please give us the assurance that you will invest that kind of amount in the networks over the next 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. And I'm sure as we sit together, we can find the ways of making that as a legal binding commitment. There could be bank guarantees, corporate guarantees, things like that. But let this shifting of money from spectrum go to the networks. If we do that, I think government would have done its job. The industry really does not need anything else.
Do you also see, that the government should be setting up a 5G infrastructure, or that should be
Government has too many problems of its own. Leave it to the private sector. Just create the environment where private sector can invest. And as I had said, let this be a little contribution by government between TSPs, between the vendors, between IP1s, we will manage the rest. We'll put up whatever investment is needed.
Wonderful. Randeep, you are back. So should we give it another shot? I think a lot of questions which are on the technologies that are needed going ahead for the new normal. Randeep?
Uh, It seems he still has issues, right?
Okay, Sanjay, I will just come to you.
Yes.
You were talking about the digital infrastructure, and you were talking about the four steps which are required.
So can you
finish that landscape, please?
So I continue from there. I talked about two. The first was flattening of the network and, bringing in automation wherever you can. The second one was about creating distributed data center architecture. So third one is what I call Uberization of OSs, BSs, and customer experience management, or CRM. Because, the systems that we build over the years, they have to die. And I know it's a pretty hard to deal with, because until they die, you can't create flexible, low-cost, agile systems. Because what we're trying to do as an industry, I think this is a problem that needs to be solved, is we're trying to take the old horse and, sharpen him so he can deal with the new normal. I think my personal observation in that is that step by step, we have to bring in Uberized system, which creates self-gratification, which are instant, which give possibilities of self-service, self-bill, and so on. And so I think that's the third one. And I think the fourth is ensuring security everywhere. I think security becomes really, really paramount as you move the workloads to the homes. Because imagine, you had as a telco, you had a fantastic state-of-the-art call center. Now you created a distributed call center where agents are working from their home. How do you ensure how the data they're dealing with is safe, how their terminals are secure? Because your security as a company is as good as your last point, which is the terminal, whether that's an iPad, a laptop, or a phone. So I think these are the four major transformations. And I think this is really why I was laying out in this way, is because this is what we are dealing with across, I can talk about Asia Pacific, Japan, but globally as well. And good news is that all telcos have taken the journey. I think some are ahead in one transformation, others are in the other. And I can tell you with confidence that Indian telcos have taken steps in this direction. Of course, as 5G business case becomes clear, the monetization becomes clear, I think they obviously will have to accelerate on all these four fronts. I think that's kind of my personal view. And I know if Randeep was able to probably say the same.
Through his phone, so I think he can chip in.
Yeah, I can chip in. Sorry for it. So two connections in parallel working, video from one and audio from another one. So I think, again, coming back on 5G, I think fiber is the key to connect at least the remote data centers and towers. Then would be spectrum. I would agree that we cannot make spectrum so expensive that the business case is not there. I also want to call out here that 5G is not just a spectrum game. 5G will need a lot of investment on radios, because the normal antennas don't get used. You use massive MIMO antennas, which are much more expensive than a normal antenna, than the RRUs. And I think on the core side, it will be probably flatter architecture, might be cheaper on this, but on radio side, it will be pretty expensive. So you'll need fiber, you'll need the radio investments. Of course, you'll need the spectrum investment. Then even from handset side, I would say, we must make sure that handset is a very key part in any technology's massification. And if the handset of today's 5G is going to be $700-$800 or even becomes $500, it will still not become a mass technology to be used in India. So I think on India's side, something around 5G handset also must be done so that it is affordable, because any technology can be monetized if more people use it. Just putting a 5G network will not have users on it, because the CP side or the UE side or the device side has to be also brought in that. From Airtel side, I think 5G is one mainstay technology which will give you really mass capacity to handle. But 4G, we must not underscore, because 4G is a technology which has really brought
India to the real connected world, especially for normal use like watching a video, or even like right now I'm using my 4G phone to speak on this. So 4G always comes in to chip in to support. So I would say even for rural areas, I think 4G would be there. 4G and 5G will coexist. And the dream of digital India, which will need these, Harmeen was talking about home care. That means the hospitals will move at home. So at that time, if there is a sensitive equipment which needs to be connected so that a remote doctor can get your this thing, you will need 5G. On 5G, there are two, 5G and 4G, both depends upon what kind of technology you're running. If you need a low latency, you need probably 5G. On 5G, there are two technologies. I read one question, which is which technology will be used for wireless to the home. 5G 3.5, which we call it sub 6, will be good enough to start for wireless to home. Today also a lot of people use 4G dongles to connect. But going forward, there's a millimeter wave, which really gives you a very high capacity, which will be used. That's where the role of small cells will come in place, because millimeter wave, the cell radius are less, but they really are able to give you great speed. So I think a combination of millimeter wave for high speed, low latency, sub 6 for a wider coverage, and 4G on low bands, sub gigahertz like we have in L900 for connecting all geographies of India. That is what will make the connected India ready, I would say, for this. It will need investment on radio side. It will need investment on fiber side. I think government can help on radio by spectrum. Government can help on infrastructure through a very simplified, low cost, or actually free ROW, so that we can actually go ahead and double down and invest more and more fiber. Countries which are very high on digitization have very strong fiber infrastructure that would be needed, and countries will also need high spectrum tranches so that we can do. So this is what I say would be used. Last, if I may add, would be also microwave spectrum, which will play a very key role. India should make E-band and V-band kind of technologies available, because it is still not allowed. It has been deliberated for long enough. I think E-band is something which must be given right now, so that we can start using these technologies. India would be a different challenge, but having done what we have done with 4G, I think the partner ecosystem and the telcos can bring 5G and bring up higher in the speed on a race, which, as Akhil says, we have not yet started running. So that's from my side, but we can take questions as they come.
Yeah, sure. There is one question associated with that, which talks about delinking of 3300 to 3600 megahertz spectrum from the next auction.
Yeah, so I think this is a sub-6, as we call it, which is this thing. Like we read the news yesterday about New Zealand saying New Zealand was going for an auction. They said now our country needs much more robust wireless connectivity, so they made that spectrum free. I think government should deliberate and see what is the best way to allot this spectrum. Like, I think again, I will allude to what Akhil said. There should be some rollout obligation built in, which could say that you will connect at least the industries or the key areas faster so that they can start using the technology. I think it will be somewhere in between where this has to be done.
So, Randeep, this is a question from Mr. N.K. Goel, president of TIMA and CMAI. He says, while we talk of latest technologies of 4G, 5G, and so on, let us also appreciate that substantial part of India still remains uncovered, especially in the hill areas, the northeast, LWE, aspirational districts, rural areas, etc. And especially, when we started putting the tracing apps, Arogya Setu on computers, we realized that all of India is not connected, all of India does not have smart mobiles and so on. So therefore, what needs to be done to get still that, number of Indians who are not connected with the latest technologies, how do we get them in?
So there are two answers. One is the network side, one is the customer side. I think network side, there are some projects in USOF. Airtel itself is rolling out a USOF project in Northeast. I agree, at least Northeast side, there are many areas, many villages which are still not connected. With this current USOF, some will get connected. These are very tough terrains. We are running our networks there. Electrification is not there. Roads are not there. But there is inhabitation. There are Indians living there. So I think, yes, that work needs to happen on connecting the those remote areas, but majority of the areas are still, I would say, under 4G connection. But there are a few more USOF projects which are in pipeline. I think they will further connect those remote areas. I think it, what is left is probably remote hill areas. Otherwise, plain areas are mainly connected. But are they connected with high-speed 4G? Maybe not, because the high-speed 4G, when we go talk about sub-gigahertz, they may be connected on L900 or L850, which will give you a 4G connectivity, but not the same kind of speed you would like to enjoy or what you enjoy in cities where we have TD spectrum being deployed as well, and TD has a range to cover. So I think more densification will help on 4G part. On USOS projects will help on covering those remote areas which are not yet covered. Last, on UE side, on Arogya Setu, this app runs on a data connection. So we have still lots and lots of Indians who still use a 2G phone, and their basic need till this Arogya Setu came in, which needs, they also need to be aware of what's around them. Their basic need was to make a voice call. And for voice call, 2G is pretty, I would say, good technology for a voice user who just wants to call. And so I think on 4G, to make it a 4G technology, affordable handset again start making a play, where a 2G affordable handset can be even as 1,000 rupees. But a good, a decent screen phone, which has a GPS, which has a camera, would still be more expensive, which may not be affordable to many, many Indians right now. So I would say that part will still have to be tackled, where how affordable UEs can be given to Indians who can then migrate to 4G and start using data. And from 4G connections, we should use USOF kind of projects to cover the rural areas. Plus, on our own also, we are covering areas which are key, and we get a lot of customers saying we should be covering that. I hope that answers.
Yeah, that is a fantastic, you know, covers all the aspects. Harmeen, a question that has come for you is regarding collaboration tools that you talked about. It says the enablement by operators has been mostly to resell products of others, for instance, collaboration tools. Is that going to change with the Prime Minister emphasizing on self-reliance? Isn't this the opportunity for tech behemoths like Airtel to convert this into making more of such like technology, collaboration technology itself?
Yes, it definitely could be. I think what we've got to see is, I think it's not only you know, for Airtel or us or any of the industry, is that as we are looking to do more in India, what would be the right thing that we should, what is the right technology, right tools, right products, where we should actually go and invest more, and where it doesn't really matter even if we are using something that was developed outside. I think in 2020, we are way past that point that any country can build anything and everything completely themselves and survive. What we are talking about build in India, if we want Apple to come and build in India and move some of their factories from China to India, I don't think US is going to do that if we say we are never going to use any American technology. So I think somewhere a sensibility factor is going to, and a practical factor is going to have to come into this as well. I think for us as a telecom industry, there are many other things. If there are things that we feel, whether it's things like security, whether it's security for companies or security for consumers, privacy of data, all of those things, whatever we need to do to secure those, to invest much more in that, it makes a hell lot of sense, because that's where you're truly protecting India and Indians. At the same time, for our own use, things we can manufacture here makes a whole lot of sense, not only from a perspective of just manufacturing in India and keeping the industry going, but much more from a sense of also being able to maintain the costs at a reasonable level if we are able to do that. And that's what China really did in their model. They've not allowed you know, many companies like Google, etc., to come in and have the same penetration as we've done in India. But on the other hand, they have made sure that American companies, etc., and the whole world is actually manufacturing out of there. So somewhere that very clear definition of what would be differentiated, where India could, as a country, be differentiated, and not for the sake of it saying, I just invented this here, when something much better is already prevalent in other parts of the world. Moving that for consumers is going to be difficult. So I think it's some of those things are definitely going to come, and some of those things we are still going to continue to use tech from the rest of the world. I think in 2020 we are saying we're going to start developing an Indian search engine, and that's what's going to go in, crawl the globe and build that and everybody 1.3 billion of them move to that. I think that's going to be tough.
That's absolutely true. And in that light, Akhil would like to ask you a question about what are the differences that you see between the Chinese industry and the Indian telecom industry. What sort of changes need to be made? And a question there is also that Huawei has been a leader as far as 5G is concerned, but now with concerns around Huawei, is there who should be driving the 5G revolution here in India?
Sorry, which comparison of Indian telecom industry with which industry? Sorry.
The Chinese telecom industry.
Chinese telecom. Well, I think telecom industry world over is the same. The difference in China is they can do whatever they want. In a jiffy, we can't. We are dependent on too many other factors, but otherwise, fundamentally, it's the same. I think for telecom industry, I feel the biggest role is providing connectivity, and that's where if we were to focus and then let everybody build whatever they can over on top of that. Our job, at least, I'm not a technologist, but I see the best thing we can do, and everybody in the telecom industry do, is to provide that vital middleware where there can be a plug and play model where people can plug in their products or applications, and we can seamlessly give it to all our customers. Whether we are able to do some of them ourselves is not important. Can we build that middleware, and can we build the robust networks which Sanjay and Randeep spoke about? And I think Harmeen put it very nicely. We do not need to reinvent the wheel here. For instance, we have collaborated with Apollo, right, on the telemedicine side. Now, it will be ridiculous for us to try and gather all the doctors and say we'll specialize in heart care and lung care and so on. That's not needed. We need to just be the link and provide that. Whether that's a Chinese telecom industry or Indian telecom industry, doesn't really matter. On Huawei, I'm sure if one company or one country's companies are not able to supply, there will be others who will come up. But I guess Sanjay is obviously waiting in the wings, looking at opportunities. And I'm sure a whole lot is developing there, where it's moving from the so-called specialized vendors who made these equipments to more scattered one, which I think Randeep spoke about or Bill talked about. But yeah, it's not going to be dependent just because one company can't provide.
Yeah.
So Sanjay, there was this question for you also, 5G technologies versus Cisco technologies and HP Aruba and so on. Your views on that?
So I think I wrote a short message there. So I mean, my sense is in a country of our size, 5G and Wi-Fi 6 will coexist. And I think together these two technologies will be able to enable use cases, that you can take to industries. And so I think that's kind of a short answer to that question. I would leave if Randeep has a specific comment on that, but I think clearly there is room for both and they will have to coexist. And, we do this annual internet traffic report. We used to call it VNI. So that report also came out in the middle of this crisis. And I mean, all indications are that irrespective of where the technologies are evolving, because it looks from a consumer point of view or enterprise point of view, what do they need? And let me give you data points. On mobile, 2018, we were at 4.6 meg average. In 23, we're forecasting 16.3 megabits per second, average user. On the fixed, we were at 15 meg, and we are forecasting 40 megabits per second. And Wi-Fi speeds were at 8.2, and we are forecasting 26 megabits per second. So if you have to go there with those kind of data rates, I think we need all sorts of technologies. I mean, for sure, Wi-Fi 6 has a role to play. 5G, if it is launched, will be the mainstream with a combination of Wi-Fi 6 will create compelling enablement to create the use cases that industry needs. So that's an answer to that question. Hey, I had one more remark, you know, connected to the question you asked, Akhil. You know, I promised you we assist for the last 5 years. I was in, before going to Singapore, I was in India for many years, 5, 6 years, 4 years working with Cisco. We looked at it 4 years, and I think we decided to set up a factory in Pune. I promise you, it just, because there's no ecosystem behind. You need components, you need strong power grid, you need, so if government really wants the industry to go step up the game on kind of make in India, they need to put an infrastructure and possibilities to seamlessly export it from India, because all that will be needed to make it a interesting manufacturing hub. I think that's kind of one comment. And second, to Harmeen's point, I mean, if every country thinks about indigenous, you know, make in India or make in America or keep it limited to your country, I promise you this world will become very, very inefficient. And what costed $1 today will start to cost $5. So I think that's dangerous for our industry as well. If we all start building everything in every country, it just wouldn't be efficient.
Yeah, that's right. I think collaboration is absolutely key. But connected with the collaboration, Harmeen, there are, by the way, sorry, we have overshot our time, but I will be finishing in another 5 minutes. Sorry, we have had some technical glitches, and because of that, the discussion has gone a bit longer, but I promise that in another 5 minutes, we will finish that. So, Harmeen, the question which is there for you is that with all these collaborations, etc., what about the privacy concerns and security concerns? How do you need to address these?
I think as Indians, we are actually, looking at the rest of the world, we're probably less concerned with our privacy than we should be. I think this is where I feel that a lot of other companies coming from outside are able to take our data of not only us as a country, but us as individuals as well, and monetize us far better than we do in India. And I think that is something that should definitely, you know, we've got to look at that in a different light and see how we can truly evolve conscientiously as well as create more awareness. Because I think a large part of India today is not even aware of what kind of information that they are, what footprint they are leaving behind, what is the impact of that, and how it can really impact their lives as well. And I think that is something that as a country we've got to get much better at. And I think for corporates as well, there is a many of the times that data leakages and phishing attacks happen, data leakages happen, and ignorance is bliss, because we don't know, we don't realize, hence we never go and invest in tightening those things up. Only when something either comes out into the papers or something has a far more detrimental impact and some customer causes a different complaint, that's when a large part of the organizations then go hustling around. For us, this has been a very key focus from day one, because we, with over 300 million customers that we support, data privacy is paramount and has to be part of our DNA more than anything else. So we see a lot more of this. When people are downloading apps today, we just when it comes up with those terms and conditions, how many of us have actually read those to say what access are they taking? We just say agree and we move forward. And then later on, someday later, somebody will write and say, this data ended up on Facebook, and how did that happen? So a lot of those things, I think, if we as we move into the digital world, that level of education is important, but I think that conscientiousness in companies is far more important, because regardless of whether my consumer is aware and savvy of that and all, that doesn't obligate me from my rights. And this is where a lot of companies, especially in the social networking space, I do have a fundamental disconnect with that, because they feel as long as the user is unaware, I can use that data. And I think our moralities as organizations needs to be far higher than this, and as a country as well.
Yeah, very, very well put. Randeep, last question to you. Sanjay talked about that, you know, you need to have technologies coexisting. And therefore, what is your view on, you know, how speedily we need to in 5G or other technologies, and what can be done to accelerate the whole process?
No, I think it's right. The technologies have been coexisting for some time, like Wi-Fi technology as an access. We all use Wi-Fi in home, because if you have to have connected multiple devices, and the cheapest modem or chip which could be is Wi-Fi, which is there in all devices, and especially in a smart home, you'll find Wi-Fi will be the connective things. As you go out, probably 3GPP technology like 4G and subsequently 5G would be. So it will coexist in my view. Interworking could be there, could not be there in some cases, but it will coexist for sure. 5G will fill certain other requirements which are not today possible with what happens with the unlicensed band is that in an unlicensed band, the control on the service provider of quality of service is limited, because you are using the same frequency. Like in Wi-Fi at home also, if you use 2.4, it is interfered with your neighbor's 2.4, you could have some issues. So I would say licensed band will give you a more secure, reliable connection, and telco will be able to manage. But for a cheaper connection, which is more public, maybe Wi-Fi side will have to coexist with. There was a question on security. I mean, there is a question on security which Harmeen answered, which is more from a user's data privacy. Is second from a network security perspective. These all technologies are designed for a very secure network access, and it is not possible for external people to enter so easily. I'm not saying that there are no security which happens. These threats keep happening time and again, but more new technologies are built with a higher security robustness, I would say. Like 5G, a lot of people have a 5G security question mark. But unlike 4G, where was security was a bolt-on, in 5G, the security is built-in. So there are a lot of security, you can say, protocols and things which are put in 5G to make it secure. Reason being that 5G will be there as a user technology, but will also be a industrial technology where industries will run their industries out of it. So you have to make it secure, because the vital data of the industry will fly through this. So I would say it is very, very secure, and even 4G and 5G, and we do keep making sure that we are abreast with the latest firmware and software from the providers on that. So there's another question I'm reading, is that should we fast track our trials? Actually, in our labs and in the in IMC, Indian Mobile Congress, 5G has been demoed. It is a commercial technology now. Many countries are already using it. So I think rather than trial, it should be more on, let's start rolling it out in a way where it can start enabling some of the Digital India initiatives and make us, more self-reliant or Atmanirbhar, as we say, in certain parts where you don't have to depend. It has to be coexistent. I want to add one more point on what Harmeen said, that we can't just stop using foreign technology, because then it will be a long road ahead of us before we can create all those technologies. I would say we should pick up some use cases, which with India's given geographical spread, you can say economic condition and the vastness of the country, I think we will have certain use cases which we will develop, and we should be exporting use cases to the world rather than and participating in the technology development further. I mean, 5G is just a start, as we know. 4G also, when it started to where it is now, it has developed a lot. Maybe as the R&D or the development community, there is a lot of work done on the standard part in India, where we can participate in the world and give some use cases which are relevant to India will also be relevant to many similar countries. So I think we should co-create and participate in the world development, and there should be something we should import, something we should export. On manufacturing, like I think Sanjay mentioned, Two of our suppliers, Ericsson and Nokia, have factory here in India, while Huawei and ZTE don't have, Cisco doesn't have. I think it needs scale, one. And second, big support on many things like power, space, transport, robust infrastructure, components, because majority of the components in even in those manufacturers still have to come from non-Indian suppliers. So, but I think it's an opportunity. Every crisis is an opportunity. It's a reset opportunity. We should really look at it and seeing how we can bring India on telecommunication front at least to the forefront and start contributing to the world, just not by consumption, but also on technology.
Wonderful. I think, you know, that was a great answer. And you also sort of echoed what the Prime Minister was saying about, you know, making local into vocal and global and so on. So, you know, I think we have sort of run out of time, but thank you for, you know, sharing with us how the industry took care of the crisis, of sharing that, you know, what will be the world after COVID, how the telecom industry is going to react to that, what kind of technologies, what kind of infrastructure, what kind of investments are going to be made. Thank you indeed. It has been a great discussion. And over to you, Shubhendu, to wrap up.
Thank you, PG. A big thanks to all the speakers. It was a pleasure listening to you and learning from you all. I hope the participants enjoyed it as much as I did. And there's a lot of content. I look at it from my editorial perspective and from the magazine perspective. We will be covering it, transcribing this entire discussion, and we will be taking it forward from there. I'd also take this opportunity to thank
Shubhendu, sorry to interrupt you for just 1 second. There are number of, you know, on the question panel, I can see that people still have more questions. So what we will do is that we will compile the questions that we have not been able to answer today, and we will send it to the panelists and request you to, you know, in your time, if you can provide answers to that, which we will send it back to the participants. Sorry.
So definitely we are, that's the process we follow. We will be capturing the questions. Some of them have already been answered, and the rest we will be taking forward editorially, as well as, you know, will be because we have the participants' ID, and we will be sending it to the panelists. Some of the panelists may answer it, and we'll send it back. So with this, I'd like to thank Cisco and the team also for supporting the webinar, which we were conducting on WebEx. And we now conclude this today's session, and I request the participants to share the feedback so that we can improve our sessions, make it better for the next sessions. And, you know, just for information, we'll be sharing the recording of this session as an on-demand video on Voice and Data website. So feel free to share with those who have not attended it, and if in case you want to watch it. And with this, I'd like to say thank you. And till the next edition of our TLF dialogue, have a nice evening. Stay safe, stay healthy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.